As was stated previously by people who know more than I do, what the United States can do is so simple and so obvious. We have the power to prevent this from happening. We have the power to prevent the camp from closing. We have the power to make the Iraqi government act responsibly. And so Elie Wiesel taught us that the major lesson of the Holocaust is always believe the threats of your enemies more than the promises of your friends. And we're seeing that presented so dramatically here today. The threats of the enemies of the residents of Camp Ashraf are so clear, they're not trying to hide anything. Listen. Listen to the loudspeakers. Listen to what they're saying. They're not hiding their intentions. And then what about the promises? The United States made promises. Great countries keep their promises. Moral people keep their promises. We have an obligation to keep our promises that we made to those people who we disarmed when we told them that they had to give up any kind of arms. We promised them protection. There are obligations that come with promises. Obligations under law, obligations under diplomacy, obligations under morality. I will tell Samantha Power that I don't want to have to write a book called A Problem from Nowhere, because this is not a problem from hell. This is a problem that is easily solvable. And the solution is in the hands of this administration. It is in the hands of the President of the United States, who is meeting with the head of Iraq. And if the President of the United States sits silent during that meeting, the head of Iraq will leave that meeting thinking he has an imprimatur to go ahead and close Camp Ashraf. Silence is not an option for the President. Silence is complicity. Silence is facilitation. Silence is permission. And silence in some contexts can be a crime. Let me explain. The criminal law criminalizes omissions, criminalizes the failure to act when there is a responsibility to act. Crimes are not only actions, they are inactions as well. International law has previously been applied to those who, by their inaction, have allowed or facilitated massacres. And the United States government is in a position where by its silence, it may become complicit in a crime. Our country doesn't want to do that. We are a great country. We have a moral president, a moral secretary of state. We have moral people in positions of authority. We want to do the right thing. It's easy not to act, but failure to act clearly is a responsibility. The Bible says, do not stand idly by the blood of your neighbor. It could have been describing Camp Ashraf today. We cannot stand idly by the blood of the inmates of that camp.
Next week, President Obama will be meeting with the Prime Minister of Iraq. I pray that President Obama is not silent. I pray that he uses that First Amendment to the Constitution to express his opinion. I pray that he recognizes your gathering. I pray that he petitions the government of Iraq. And I pray that he is not silent. He is cognizant, and that he is courageous. Because you see, the United States has a disproportionate responsibility. The United States promised to protect the people of Camp Ashraf. The United States promised that the people of Camp Ashraf would have the Geneva protections of a protected people. The United States has an obligation to follow through on that promise, and it has a responsibility to make sure that Prime Minister Maliki fully understands the promise and that there are consequences if it's not kept. The United States has an obligation to keep its promise. The United States also has an obligation to recognize, I think, a growing legal recognition that the MEK, the PMI, is not a terrorist organization. The courts in the United States have spoken and challenged the State Department to make the decision. And the decision is ripe. In fact, it's overripe. And it should be announced before Prime Minister Maliki meets with President Obama. And the State Department should say, the MEK is not a terrorist organization and they should be delisted.
Si je suis ici cet après-midi avec vous, c'est parce que nous ne sommes qu'à 21 jours, qu'à quelques jours de l'échéance illégale et injuste concernant la fermeture du camp d'Ashraf. Si je suis ici cet après-midi avec vous, c'est parce que, comme secrétaire général adjoint des Nations Unies, je ne peux accepter que le gouvernement irakien continue de faire pression pour expulser les résidents d'Ashraf et parce que ce gouvernement fait obstruction à toutes les tentatives du Haut Comité pour les réfugiés et de la mission d'assistance de l'ONU en Irak afin de résoudre la crise et éviter une véritable tragédie humaine. Si je suis ici cet après-midi avec vous, c'est pour rappeler le contexte, c'est pour demander aux médias de s'intéresser enfin à ce drame qui se joue sous mes yeux. Oui, les résidents d'Ashraf ont accepté d'être réinstallés dans les pays tiers et ont approuvé le plan proposé par le Parlement européen. Oui, en 2011, les résidents d'Ashraf ont soumis leur demande d'asile international et individuel au Haut Comité pour les réfugiés pour reconfirmer leur statut de réfugiés. Oui, le 13 septembre 2011, le Haut Comité pour les réfugiés a annoncé que les résidents d'Ashraf étaient tous reconnus demandeurs d'asile et leur a accordé une reconnaissance internationale ainsi qu'une protection qui doit être reconnue par le gouvernement irakien. Le moment est donc venu, mes amis, de dire, d'ici, de Paris, premièrement que tout déplacement ne serait acceptable que si les casques bleus sont en charge de la protection des habitants. Comme le secrétaire général des Nations Unies l'a rappelé récemment, aucune décision ne pourrait être prise sans l'aval des habitants d'Ashraf et de leurs représentants. Trois, que l'inscription par le Haut Comité des réfugiés, aux réfugiés des Nations Unies, de chacune et de chacun des habitants d'Ashraf doit se faire, cette inscription, impérativement à l'intérieur du camp et non pas à l'extérieur. Quatre, que tout déplacement d'un Ashrafien doit obligatoirement se faire après identification par le HCR. Et que, 5, l'Union européenne, la France, le gouvernement français et également le gouvernement américain doivent peser sur l'Irak pour interdire le déplacement des habitants, faire reporter l'ultimatum de la fermeture d'Ashraf pour que le Haut Comité aux réfugiés puisse effectuer sereinement son travail dans le camp protégé par la communauté internationale.
Now, we have the particular problem of Camp Ashraf, which is in a way a continuation of the malice of the mullahs without mercy. We've had General Phillips' testimony
today that confirms that they were formally recognized as protected persons under the Geneva Convention. Well, let me tell you that once you are defined and listed as a protected person under the Geneva Conventions, how long does that last? It lasts until you no longer need protection, and they need protection today. So not only do we have the problem, not only are they protected under the Geneva Convention, but we have the decommissioning. The decommissioning process went on in 2003, and the result of that was that in the deputy commander of the coalition forces praised the residents of Camp Ashraf for working together in the spirit of common humanitarianism and confirmed the coalition's endorsement of their right to be protected from violence and their right as refugees not to be what we lawyers call refouled, that is, sent back to Iran, where they will without doubt be executed. So their safety seemed assured, and it seemed assured after they did the world great service by revealing Iran's secret nuclear facility at Natanz. And of course, that deepened the hatred of them by the Iranian regime, which began its diplomatic pressure on Iraq to destroy Camp Ashraf.
And I want to say to all those Department of State advisors of the president who are preparing him for his meeting with Nouri al-Maliki that first and foremost, there is another phrase that has been left out of today's discussion but is pertinent, and that is, history is doomed to repeat itself if you fail to learn from it. And we have State Department, Secretary Gates met with Nouri al-Maliki on July just before the 27th, 8th, and 9th attacks, and was assured by the Iraqi government that they would not do anything. And then they did. April 7th, Secretary Gates once again met Nouri al-Maliki, assured that nothing would happen. And the next day, he ordered troops in to assault Camp Ashraf. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. This is on the conscience of the United States not to let Nouri al-Maliki lie to us once again, as he's done twice before, when he met with Secretary Gates the first time on July 2009, and when he met with Secretary Gates the second time on April 7th. Do not let this happen again, Mr. President, because if Nouri al-Maliki meets with you on the 12th, and 3 weeks later he commits one of the greatest violations of human rights and crimes against humanity by assaulting and murdering the 3,400 unarmed refugees of Camp Ashraf, that will be too much for our country to have to explain that we did not know that it was going to happen. We have been told it's going to happen. We have seen it happen twice before. Let us not use the excuse that we did not know this was going to happen.